A wholeheartedly welcome, ladies and gentlemen, in the representation of Hesse in the heart of the European Quarter. I'm Peter Müller. I'm the director of the Spiegel here in Brussels, and I'm very happy to welcome you to a discussion with Elisa Ferreira. She is Commissioner for Cohesion Policy and Reforms. And our topic is chosen very well, just one day before the big EU summit, because we would like to talk about the way out of the corona crisis, the role of the structural reforms and the cohesion policy. And the good thing is you can ask questions. You will see an email address where you can write your questions, or even you use the phone number to give us your questions. And before I start with the commissioner, we will have a welcome Mrs. Lucia Puttrich, who is the Minister for European Affairs. Ladies and gentlemen, I wholeheartedly welcome you to another event in the series One Click to Europe. This is not just another event. We are delighted today to welcome a European Commissioner for the first time. We are eager to learn from Commissioner for Cohesion Policy and Reforms, Mrs. Ferreira, about the challenge that lie ahead of the European Union. And there will be many. We are right now in the midst of the corona crisis, but also in a moment where we have to conclude with the multi-annual finance plan. This plan lasts 7 years in order to adapt everything in the European Union. At the same time, we have an urgent short-term recovery package is required for the recovery in the EU, and in the MMF we have a lot of things to do over short and long time. For us as a region in Hesse, it is very important that we need a cohesion fund, because also strong regions need to remain strong. After all, only a powerful engine is capable of hauling all the other wagons on the train. And yet we are aware of the fact that prosperous regions too have suffered heavily in the current crisis. In Italy, for example, it's therefore vital to take a closer look at where the financial support is directed. One thing is certain, we want to emerge stronger from this crisis, and we want to strive in the European Union because we need a strong internal market. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, I'm looking forward to hearing the Commissioner's assessment of the challenges ahead, especially also with regard to a relatively prosperous region like Hesse. And I'm very happy that we have as a facilitator Peter Müller. Please listen, take part, and I'm looking forward to an interesting debate.
Now it's our turn to talk. Before that, I briefly want to introduce you. You're an economist by training. You have been working in various different posts in the Portuguese government. You have been MEP here in Brussels in the European Parliament for quite some time, from 2004 to 2016. You've been the vice governor of the Bank of Portugal, and in 2019 you became the commissioner for cohesion policy, for cohesion and reforms, which is the official title. And as I said at the very beginning, we are very lucky to have you here today, a day before the European summit starts, which of course will debate on the recovery instrument, on all these big billions of money which might be spent. And I basically wanted to kick off this conversation in asking you what your expectations for the summit are. Do you think there will be over the weekend an agreement which will bring Europe forward? How do you assess the chances that there will be some kind of deal over the weekend?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for this invitation. It's a pleasure for me. And in fact, I hope and I expect that a deal will be made. For the simple reason that Europe needs it. Mm-hmm. Citizens are waiting for it, and we need it. Mm. Because the level of the recession that that we are already perceiving requires that there is action.
Yeah.
And so I think what we should not disregard was the risk that for lack of capacity to bridge differences, to find the essential path to mm-hmm. go through, we would postpone a decision, because I think waiting in this kind of circumstances improves nothing.
Yeah.
And actually, it jeopardizes a lot of yeah. elements that we still have in our economy,
yeah.
in your social welfare. And so I hope, I expect that a deal will be made this week.
Yeah.
But if they have to prolong to 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, let's do it.
It's, of course, very complicated, that the points which have to be discussed. I mean, there is the multi-annual framework, which alone is worth probably different summits, multiple summits to come to a solution. And there's the recovery instrument. There's also a huge amount of money involved. And the German Chancellor, Angela Merkel, already warned that the package shouldn't be downsized, because it should have an impact. Now, you know financial markets, you know economy, you've been vice governor of the central bank. Is the package big enough to make an impact for financial markets?
It's, I think it's the minimum that can be seen as mm-hmm. a proper answer.
Yeah.
And I think, in fact, Chancellor Merkel has been extremely, extremely constructive. And I think, in fact, Europe will remember her mm-hmm. as someone that when the time came, she was there to help.
Yeah.
The Commission, I think, was very brave to make such a proposal, a bold proposal. Mm-hmm. I think citizens were expecting Commission to take action. But of course, Commission has then to have the agreement of the Council. And the proposal from the French-German or German-French deal or proposal that opened the doors for the Commission to be confident mm-hmm. that once the Commission had been worked on would be presented, would have some sort of open table for negotiation yeah. from the side of the Council. And I think citizens are waiting. They mm-hmm. are looking at us, all of us. And of course, there are lots of jobs. There are lots of restart of business.
Yeah.
There is a lot of also financial markets attention.
Yeah.
Waiting to see if this proposal is really feasible. It
yeah.
is going to be taken seriously.
Yeah.
If it is going to be implemented or not, and I think all of us feel that the moment is now, and so I hope we
let's
we
look
get
at
it
this.
Done.
Let's look at this proposal and about some of the details the heads of states and mm-hmm. government will be dealing with tomorrow. First of all, of course, there is the debate on the criteria of how it's determined how the money should go to which country. And the Commission proposed that it should be the unemployment figures of the last 5 years, which mm-hmm. should be played a key role there. This has now changed a little bit with economic forecasts coming in. Is this, in your point of view, a good way to come up with the distribution of this huge amount of money?
There are several elements in the package.
Mm-hmm.
One element, very important element as well, is the support to the business and to the real economy.
Yeah.
You are referring to one of the pieces of the proposals,
yeah.
An important one for sure.
Yeah.
But I think it would be probably better if we had the conditions to do it, and we are doing it in one of the of these instruments, which is called REACT.
Yeah.
It will take 2 years. It will be an instrument for 2 years, immediately reaction, as the acronym goes for.
Yeah.
So immediate reaction, and for this we are already using the estimate, not the estimates, mm-hmm. the not forecasts, mm-hmm. but the real figures of the drop in GDP.
Yeah.
That will take place between the year 2019 and the year 2020. Yeah. But because we are waiting for the statistics, we can only make the allocation among member states
yeah.
of this 55 billion instrument after the summer, because we have to have the first semester
True.
Statistics. That's
yeah.
Evident. For this big package that will take 4 years, that
yeah.
is a more long-term structural kind of instrument, I think the estimates that we have based on a GDP, so on the relative prosperity mm-hmm. of member states, on the unemployment figures from the past, and also on the capacity of member states to and the population and capacity of member states to redress themselves. So it's a combination. I think it's a proxy, and this has been tested by the services of the Commission, and it is a reasonable kind of proxy to what is the real impact of the crisis.
The next question, which I think will be maybe even in the middle of debates tomorrow, is of course the question of governance. So who should determine and give the kickstart of giving the money out? And there's a Dutch proposal which says it should be all the member states anonymously. This clearly is going too far. What is your thinking behind what would be a good governance structure?
Let's be frank. We have got to have a governance that guarantees that what the instruments are there for
works.
Yeah. Delivers.
Yeah.
I think the Commission is the author of this proposal. Mm-hmm. It is the Commission that will go to the markets and issue that. And I think it is the Commission that has, not only from a legal point of view, but also from a substantive point of view, the capacity to understand how and where you should really concentrate your efforts. We have been working with cohesion policy instruments for decades.
Yeah.
We have all the mechanics to do it. And we can really enlarge it to cover reforms and to cover other type of instruments. Of course, we have got to understand the role of the Council.
Yeah.
In the later stage, the Council guarantees the budget of the Commission.
Yeah.
So there is a reason, of course. Mm-hmm. But one thing is to have this kind of broad guarantee. The other is to interfere directly in the kind of policies that member states are proposing.
Yeah.
So the proposal from the Commission makes sense. It's a Commission-based and community-based proposal. I know that, and we all know that the Council wants to get in more and more, but we have got to have a limit because the experience in the past with ESM and other intergovernmental instruments left a bit of a sense that we could have done better with those instruments.
This is exactly where I'm heading to now. My third question on the package is has to do with control, with oversight. You mentioned the ESM, which also in a way is ready to hand out millions and billions of money, and nobody takes it because people have, of course, the euro crisis still in the back of their minds and the troika visiting countries which got money from Brussels. So how do you avoid in this new program that again there is some kind of troika moment which clearly southern European countries are not fond of having?
Well, I think it's not actually southern or northern or eastern. It's the issue that the logic from someone that lends money and wants to get it to make sure that the money is paid back.
Yeah.
And sometimes in the European discussion, there is this argument: okay, it's a very generous kind of approach. I mean, in most cases, with the exception of a small support to Greece, but in most cases, this was lending and it was paid back with interest. Mm-hmm. So it was not really a kind of a gift.
Yes.
It was a gift in the sense that those countries, they could not borrow in the international markets because it helped.
Yeah.
It helped, but it was not bad business. This was good business. But the logic to get our money back is sometimes in conflict with the need that we have in Europe for those regions and our member states that really don't have the sufficient level of competitiveness, the quality of their urban resources, quality of their education. They have to catch up. Mm-hmm. And there must be a room for these countries to catch up and these regions to catch up in order to be able to play the central game of the European economic agenda, that is free competition.
Yeah.
With free competition, you need to have more balanced kind of regions and more balanced economic sectors that can actually compete.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the winner takes it all.
Yeah.
So for a common currency and a common market to work, you really have to have these instruments that are there since the beginning for catching up. Now, with the crisis, the imbalances increased massively, and we have got to correct them if we want the internal market to function, because even the most prosperous countries, they will not be able to reap the benefit from the internal market if more than half of the internal market is in recession.
Yeah.
There is no one to buy.
You say that, Commissioner, you say that the Commission should be in the driving seat when it goes about distributing this money. As we are in the heart of the European quarters, we can do a bit of a Brussels bubble question, I think. Who in the Commission? Is it DG Regio? Is it DG ECFIN? I think the turf wars.
That is not settled.
Is it the president and the director general?
That is not settled. It depends on what you want the countries to do. Mm-hmm. We have created also in the aftermath of the crisis, we have created the European semester.
Yeah.
The European semester started by being a very macro financial kind of approach. But then it evolved. And it evolved in order that you make recommendations to the different member states. And these recommendations progressively have touched upon other sectors, other areas, rather than pure the outcome of your debt, your deficit, and some macroeconomic variables. And this will be the basis. So the proposal from the Commission makes the semester as the kind of right structure on which you can anchor. New requests, new demands, because now we really want to catch up, but we don't want to that member states look forward with methods from the past.
Yeah.
So the greening, the digital, and the cohesion have got to be elements of the same story, so that really you reestablish sound conditions for future growth. Yeah. The Green Deal was already there.
Yeah.
Now it is more relevant than before that you do it right. Yeah.
Before I come to my next question, I want to remind our listeners and viewers that they can send in questions. We have till 1:45 here. So the Commissioner has to leave sharply at 1:45. It's not till 2 o'clock. So if you have questions, start to send them in now, then I can pass them on to the Commissioner. I wanna shift our conversation now a bit from tomorrow to your overall view on cohesion policy, because for us journalists, of course, cohesion policy is often not a very sexy topic. It's complicated. It seems to be part of the old way of spending money in Europe. It's a huge amount of money, but in the end of the day, nobody really knows where it goes to, at least not when reporting from here. Does cohesion policy in this corona crisis have some kind of revival? And why is it, in your point of view, maybe a good policy, especially to tackle the fallout of the corona crisis?
I thank you for this question, because this split between old policies and new policies doesn't make any sense. Mm. In this crisis, the immediate reaction from the Commission was twofold. On one hand, we looked at the pockets of the Commission, and people sometimes forget that what Commission is doing represents 1% of the total wealth of the Union.
Yeah.
So it would be difficult to imagine a federal state, or I know that Europe is not a federal state, but as a proxy you can take it. That would work with 1% of the total wealth.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at the budgets of member states. So. But nevertheless, the envelopes from cohesion policy that were available still and allocated to the different member states, in 2 weeks, we managed, with the support of the European Parliament and of the Council, to readjust completely, to reprogram everything. And it is this money that for most countries is being used to support member states, to finance the masks, the ventilators, the unemployment, the unemployment mechanisms, this Kurzarbeit or another
Since Ms. von der Leyen is your boss, everybody has to know this in German now.
So these instruments, and also to support the small and medium enterprises, even to finance their running costs. Yeah. So this is just a proof of the capacity that altogether, in face of a crisis, we managed to use the available money.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want a more sound, a more robust kind of answer, you cannot imagine the progress that was done in the country I know the best. I'm from Portugal.
Yeah.
the massive progress that was done and the speed in mm-hmm. which this progress occurred, it mm-hmm. would never have happened without support
yeah.
of Germany, yeah. also in the beginning with the foundations.
Yeah.
And this gives a hint, because the most important German foundations were there because the country was coming from a dictatorship.
Mm-hmm.
And these foundations helped us to understand how you should yeah. organize yourself in a democracy. At mm-hmm. that time, a long time ago, it was really absolutely crucial. And since then, it has been massive. Otherwise, the open borders, the open competition could not operate.
Yeah.
You look at Poland.
Yeah.
You look at, the massive progress of Poland. It's incredible. It was due to this kind of support.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have got to look at cohesion policy also as a live policy. If you listen to the regions, and I was in Germany, I still had time before COVID
yeah.
to visit Brandenburg and to yeah. speak with people. And they really know what we are talking about.
Yeah.
Probably
yeah.
journalists could, sorry, don't take it wrong.
Go ahead.
go to the regions yeah. and speak with people and
yeah.
speak with the leaders of those regions, but yeah. also with the trade unions
yeah.
and with the entrepreneurs, and to try to understand, because it is felt. I'm not saying that everything is perfect.
Yeah.
I can also underline that progressively the cohesion policy has been absorbing the greening
mm-hmm.
and the digital
mm-hmm.
And the need to go from hard works
yeah.
like roads and railways into some more sophisticated yeah. kind of yeah. of investments and instruments. But it is really an essential policy of Europe, and mm-hmm. I think we should not disregard and not lose the sense, because sometimes there is one case of a bad judgment or a bad management, and this becomes like if it was the paradigm. It
yeah.
was not.
Yeah.
One of the first things I did when I came to this new responsibility in my life was to ask the services from the Commission the amount of fraud.
Yeah.
In the previous, when they had already closed the accounts.
Yeah.
And the percentage of fraud was 0.47%.
Okay. Okay.
So, I mean, but of course, each case is a drama,
yeah.
has got to be investigated, you have got to go to the bottom. But please don't send the baby with bathwater, because, I mean, it's at the proportion of things has got to be there. Also, when you journalists
yeah.
do a lot of positive work
mm-hmm.
in pointing to bad decisions,
mm.
bad management. Mm. I'm talking about fraud.
Mm-hmm.
But then, of course, there are bad decisions. Everybody, mm. even, I mean, we came from a banking crisis. Don't tell me that bankers did always the good decisions.
Yeah, no, nobody would say that. Before I come a bit more on this question of fraud and control, you've been to Brandenburg. Of course, there are other regions in Germany which are a bit more well-off. We are the guests in the representation of Hessen, which is
yeah.
a well-off region. And this, of course, being a house in Brussels where there are many well-off regions assembled, Emilia Romana from Italy, we have regions from Poland and France. What's in this package for more well-off regions? Of course, they are afraid that they are a bit of the losers in this new kind of revirement of aid, which is now happening.
Well, my personal belief, and I think also cohesion policy is aligned with these principles, is that you should have a policy that covers and includes everybody. That doesn't exclude, I don't like these policies in which you say, okay, this is not for me, this
mm-hmm.
is just for the poor or for those that need
mm-hmm.
Some support. That is not good. That is, in fact, our decision also in relation to the reassessment of the Just Transition Mechanism and Fund, in
mm-hmm.
which everybody is there.
Yeah.
And people were asking me, how come that you are proposing to support
yeah.
Germany? Germany can solve their problems.
Yeah.
Probably they can.
Yeah.
But the regions themselves, where things occur, they deserve some support.
Mm-hmm.
And if the crucial element is that if you are for the same problem, you are supposed to help yourself.
Yeah.
You can have an extra. The extra that you get from Brussels should be in the reverse proportion of your capacity to help yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So a region that is poorer needs more support than a region that is richer.
Yeah.
But the rich regions cannot, they also have their place. of course, they have more capacity in relation to innovation, in relation to technology. So what we are demanding from those regions is not the basic to support the basic infrastructure that you do in the most backward region of a poor country. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, they have something to give to themselves. They have often pockets inside their wealth.
Mm-hmm. That's different. Yeah.
That needs some sort of attention and support. Mm-hmm. And they also need to assume the responsibility for dragging the others with them. There is this kind of responsibility because we need economic engines, also in a spatial dimension.
Yeah.
It would not be the same thing if Germany didn't have so many poles of excellence.
Yeah.
It's good, it's a network. This gives more sustainability and more robustness to your wealth.
Yeah.
And so there is a place for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, those that need more, they are more supported. Those that need less, they are, our requests on them are higher.
Yeah.
But they are, of course, by definition, up to the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And so we all benefit from the technology, from the innovation, from the science, from the from what these regions can tell us as a kind of front leaders of progress.
Yeah.
So there is a place for everybody, I think.
You said fraud is not very high when it comes to cohesion policy. Nevertheless, of course, there are cases which are being reported, and even more so in these new negotiations now, there of course has been a big promise. And the promise by politicians was that with the next multi-annual framework, there should be some kind of rule of law mechanism. So basically, the Commission said, if we hand out money and it goes to a country which doesn't stick to basic rule of law principles, we want to have the money back or we want to shorten it. The Commission put out a proposal which was, I think, quite workable. Now Charles Michel, the Council President, changed it a bit, watered it down, many people say. What do we expect from this summit? Will we still be seeing some kind of rule of law mechanism at the end of the summit? Because clearly the dynamics of negotiations have changed. In February, countries like Germany could say, well, Mr. Orban or Poland, they need the money quite desperately. If they don't agree, then we can wait. Now, it's not only them needing the money, it's of course also countries like your own country, Italy, Spain. So it's easy in a way for Mr. Orban to say, kick out the rule of law thing, otherwise I will veto the whole recovery instrument. What's your take on that?
Well, first of all, I think we cannot disregard the importance of the rule of law, because Europe is not just an economic kind of project, or it's a project of a community of values.
Yeah.
Values such as democracy, accountability, checks and balances, respect for difference, respect for freedom. So you cannot disregard these aspects.
Yeah.
How you can address them and make them workable, and the content of what you are in fact addressing is in itself very complicated.
Yeah.
And I think, of course, from the Commission has started procedures using Article 7.
Which went nowhere in the end.
Article 7 is an atomic bomb in a way. It's very strong, and so it's not easy.
And it needs unanimity at a certain stage of the process.
So we have got really to make quick progress on that. The Commission has a responsibility when it comes to the management of funds, because funds are taxpayers' money, and we have got to be accountable to a series of entities on which you have got to be sure and to give assurance that the decisions you have taken are taken according to the rules and procedures of Europe.
Yeah.
And so this is reason why when we are talking about cohesion funds, so taxpayers' money, we have got to make sure that they are managed and that they will be implemented according to what we really think is the assurance of the quality of the mechanisms of checks and balance and democratic accountability. We made this proposal in the Commission, as you mentioned. It's still there. And let's hope that we get, of course, the Commission makes the proposal, doesn't decide.
Yeah.
Then you have got to go through the usual mechanics of the negotiation with the Council.
Yeah.
And that's just...
I mean, it's, if I might interrupt, it's you mentioned taxpayers' view, and I think one can say that even German taxpayers who are very positive when it comes to Europe, they might think if my money via Brussels is distributed to government, which openly favor gay-free zones in their country, what kind of Europe I am financing with this? So of course there's a big question which might be, because of the financial needs now due to the corona crisis, which might be dodged again in the summit, and the next chance comes in 7 years.
That's the question. How can you make the principles of Europe, when they are challenged, really, I mean, respect it.
Yeah.
And this is something on which all of us, we have got to reflect. Mm. From the Commission side, we made the proposals that we made. I stand for them.
Yeah.
Let's see how the Council reacts. But I think all of us Europeans, we have got to make sure that, in fact, we create the mechanisms that that guarantee that the community of values and principles on which we all came together, that it's still kept there. I, as I mentioned before, I come from a country that was anxious after the period where we are in a under a dictatorship. Yeah. We were anxious to be accepted in Europe because Europe was in fact the guarantor that that democracy would be there forever or forever as for the future of the country.
If you mention your country, I won't mention your prime minister, who basically was the first from the southern countries who now said, well, let's forget about this rule of law thing. We need the money now.
I don't think that is an oversimplification of what was said.
That's true, but it's not wrong.
I think it's an oversimplification. I don't know. It's up to him to define his own strategy.
Yeah.
I think also Chancellor Merkel a couple of weeks ago mentioned something like that. My message is, please. I mean, you are the negotiators from the side of the Council. Please, Council, make sure that we don't, that we get this procedure on in relation to the funding, because we need it. We need to have to offer the citizens of Europe a perspective. Mm. But on the other hand, don't forget that the rule of law has got to be implemented and not just something that is in the treaties.
Yeah.
And then you cannot really put some flesh on it. But let's work out and let's work together so that we really deliver what we need to deliver. And this is a dual objective. On one hand, respect for democracy and rule of law. And on the other hand, the appropriate reaction to the deep crisis we are in.
Would it make sense if a real biting rule of law mechanism is not possible to get in the summit? Would it then make sense to say to countries like Poland and Hungary, listen, we have this new office of the European Public Prosecutors. You're not joining so far. You're one of the very few countries who are not taking part. You have to take part if you want to have cohesion funds in the future.
I think negotiation is exactly that. Mm-hmm. If you know where you want to go, you have got to be able and to be flexible and determined enough to organize your methods of negotiation so that you reach your targets.
Yeah.
And I think also the citizens from these countries that you mentioned, they are hoping that Europe rebalances a bit the internal power. And that's the promise of Europe, and that's the condition for you to be European. So I would not take it as a kind of secondarization or minimization of the importance of the issue.
Yeah.
We are in the middle of a negotiation.
Yeah.
And so let's settle our targets and let's get the different instruments in the proper order so that we reach those targets. And these targets is to relaunch the economy of Europe. And the other one is to make sure that in practice, the rule of law works.
Our viewers have been chiming in with questions, and I want to read out one by Louise Stau, who says, which role does cohesion policy play for the Green Deal and for the digitalization? You touched on this but maybe you can elaborate a bit
yes,
on this question.
Yes, I mean, when we are talking about cohesion policy, we are talking about development.
Yeah.
And develop is not a word. I mean, you start when you are in a very poor region. You tackle the necessary, not the sufficient yeah. elements for your growth. Yeah. You have to create, and the environment is really one of the crucial elements mm-hmm. because you cannot have development if you don't have proper water, mm-hmm. if you don't have sewage, if you don't know what to do with your waste, if you don't recycle your waste, mm-hmm. If you don't have, of course, roads and railways. Yeah. So since the most simple kind of our basic projects, you have to have environment in because yeah. you have got more than ever yeah. to make a choice. I mean, do you need a road or you'd better do a railway? Yeah. Or do you need structures for yeah. private sector, yeah. private cars, or for public sector yeah. and public cars? There is an immense amount of progress we can make by redoing the energy performance of yeah. public buildings.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is when you create a public building, do it right,
yes.
don't do it wrong.
Yeah.
So of course we have limits, we have kind of objectives, mm-hmm. Like 30% of the Cohesion Fund, for instance, has got to be green. Mm-hmm. What we mean by green is not to do harm, mm-hmm. but to use the best technologies
yeah.
from an environment point of view. And of course, digital is essential because when you are talking about space,
yeah.
of course, connections, a lot of hard connections can be substituted yeah. and a lot of hard and emission transport can be substituted by adequate connections. And you know that if you want to have a balanced development, you need to create conditions for companies, for factories, for people to live outside yeah. the big conurbation where yeah. you have so many these economies of scale. So inside the DNA of cohesion policy is environment. In the past, I was Minister of Environment, so I'm very sure. Sincere when yeah. I say this, because there is no conflict between development and environment. If you want to have really a sustainable
yeah.
development, you have got to have environment embodied in it. Yeah. Otherwise, you spend money now and then you spend another amount of money to correct it. So I think it's so essential. But of course, there are limits, quantitative limits in the projects associated with different regions yeah. and different level of development of regions to guarantee that this issue is there. And thank you for the question, is that centered of cohesion?
I mean, the beauty, if I might say, of cohesion policy, I think also lies in the fact that regions have a lot to say on how the money is spent. They have to come up with the proposals and they know, in a way, of course, their own neighborhood better than maybe Brussels or even a national capital. And Rüdiger Hartz now is asking, when you contrast this, how cohesion policy has been is being handled, if you contrast this with the recovery plan and the whole setup of this plan, this plan seems to have a very strong role, of course, for the Commission, and we talked about this, when it comes to how the money is distributed. So do we also, that's his question, also see some kind of a power shift towards the Commission to the backlash of the regions when it comes to this new plan, to the disadvantage of the regions?
I don't think so, but when we talk about recovery plan, we have this smaller element, REACT. Mm-hmm. REACT is cohesion policy. The mm-hmm. envelopes, the money envelopes, will be given to the member states just for practical reasons, because yeah. we don't have, after the summer, we won't have the statistics at the NUTS 2 or NUTS 3 at the local level.
Yeah.
But we expect member states to reallocate this 55 billion
yeah.
According to the same criterion. So, supporting with this money more intensively the regions that suffer the most in economic terms and proportionately more for the same kind of drop
yeah.
of GDP, proportionately more for mm-hmm. those that cannot react by themselves. In what concerns the other recovery plan, the RRF,
yeah.
and I know the question, if the question was for one of the funds or the other, this is the bigger fund.
Yeah.
The bigger fund, if you read the text, is based on cohesion.
Yeah.
It was created, in fact, to counterbalance the different capacity of reaction yeah. of the different entities, and in particular, also there are some elements in this recovery plan that compensate for the massive state aid that certain countries like Germany could afford to give.
I mean, this is also the
but
idea,
that completely distorts. We are talking about
half of all state
aid. If this is approved, if this proposal is approved, we are talking about at the European level for 7 years, 1.85 trillion, but more than 3 trillion were given by member states and Germany, because it's very powerful economically. Almost half of this 1 trillion, of this 3 trillion, was support to the companies, and it's very good that Germany and the ones that could afford it did it, because I mean the companies didn't close, people are not unemployed. But the truth is that when we are referring to a open market, the single market, of course, the imbalances are massive. So in this recovery, there is this element, there is an element of cohesion, and there is this need. And here I go more to the substance. Because if you don't organize your public administration, your management, your policies, like the education policy, like the science and technology policy, if you cannot organize yourself in order even to use the right way the support that you are, that you receive, I mean, the money, the quality of the management is much more negative. Yeah. And in fact, when we crossed this period after 2008, the adjustment was that was recommended, sometimes kind of forced, was very short term, was very macroeconomic in terms of the macro variables, and the substance, and it ended up with a lot of brain drains, so countries left the best, the most qualified people, sale of strategic public sectors. So now we really need an element that goes into the roots on which competitiveness is grounded. Yeah. And that to address it. That's the purpose. Yeah. That's why there is this RRF.
No debate, even in these days in Brussels, without Brexit. Bas van der Berg has a Brexit question. It's the last question. When I look at the watch, we are almost running out of time. But I want to ask this question because Mr. Michel, the president of the European Council, foresees some kind of budget line now for Brexit-related consequences. What for is this money being used for? How would you use or distribute this kind of money?
This is not
fisheries in France or companies in the Netherlands or harbors in Belgium or.
This is a proposal that was made by the president of the council.
Not made by the Commission, right?
It was not a proposal from the Commission.
Yeah.
We have got to understand better what was meant by it.
Yeah.
Of course, the impacts of Brexit are also reflected in
the
drop of GDP.
Yeah. Yeah.
But of course, they may be thinking about, for instance, the impact on fisheries. That is something, if there is a hard Brexit, there are several sectors that may have this kind of approach. And I hope, I mean, the management is also based on these principles that
we've
you help those
about,
that need more to be helped, so that they also are not left behind. And that's the point of the whole thing.
Well, that's actually a good last famous sentence. Ms. Ferreira, thanks very much for
Thank
your
you
time
much
and
for
your insights. And I think maybe the viewers and me, we can look a bit more positively towards tomorrow and the summit. So maybe there even is an outcome. And after the summit outcome, of course, there's the summer break waiting. And I'm told, and I want to remind you, that this is, in a way, the last event the Hessische Landesvertretung is doing before the summer. So, wenn auch der Urlaub wahrscheinlich noch
so
nicht
if the holiday period has not arrived yet for each and everyone, because it's really starting in Brussels in August, I should like to wish to all of you from the Hessen regional representation a very healthy and profitable holiday period, and see you again in September when things are starting up again here in Brussels. Thank you very much and see you soon. Thank you.